Second Chronicles 26. Then all the people of Judah took Uzzah, who was 16 years old, and made him king in the room of his father Amaziah. All right, here's a teenager on the throne. He built Eloth and restored it to Judah. After that, the king slept with his fathers. 16 years old was Uzziah when he began to reign, and he reigned 52 years in Jerusalem. 52 years is a long time, but the longest reigning king is Manasseh, which I believe is 55 years, and the most wicked king of Judah. So we're getting in there in 8 years. His mother's name was Jechaliah of Jerusalem. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that his father Amaziah did. All right, remember? All the kings in Israel done wrong. There wasn't one right among them. Judah, they had right kings and they had wrong kings. Here's a right king that did what he was supposed to. And he sought God in the days of Zechariah. Now this is not the Zechariah whom the book is, in the book of Zechariah the prophet. This is another Zechariah who had understanding in the visions of God. And as long as he sought the Lord, God made the prosper. Now you know by that statement, as long as he sought the Lord, you know, okay, trouble's coming around the corner. You know, we're born again Christians until we, you know, we live right until something in our life. We're not perfect. We're not sinless yet. One day when we die or the rapture happens, we will be then sinless. Perfection. But not until then. And he went forth and warred against the Philistines. Now it's been a while since the Philistines have been in the picture and warring. And this time instead of Philistines coming out against Israel, he's going out against the Philistines. And break down the wall of Gath, and the wall of Javanith, and the wall of Ashdod, and built cities about Ashdod among the Philistines. So he tears down the defense fortresses of these cities. He's powerful enough that in order to go break down a wall, several walls, he's got to defeat the army. You just don't go up there and start taking the walls down. The army just sit back and drink Coca-Cola and coffee all day. They're going to put a fight up. So the thing is, in verse 6, is he was victorious. And God helped him against the Philistines. And when God's your helper, God's your aid, you're going to do everything and anything that God wants you to do. And against the Arabians that dwelt in Gerbaal and Mahanims. Arabians, again, they're of Ishmael, or of the other children of Abraham, and their enemies. The Arabians show up in Ezra as enemies to the temple being built. They show up as enemies when the walls of Jerusalem being built. They're enemies of God's people today. And King Uzziah went in there and beat them up because God was with them. Now, if Israel is doing right today, I'm not saying Israel is God's people. Are not God's people. They are. God is going to redeem them. They are backsliding. They are living against the will of God today. And a Jew will go to hell today if he does not believe on Jesus Christ as his Savior. But that doesn't mean God is done with the nation of Israel. He's going to give them at least 7 years of tribulation, 3.5 years of great tribulation under the Antichrist. He's going to use the devil and the Antichrist to whip them, to beat them, as a father beats his children. Then he's going to call them back to himself. And imagine if they were to get right under God. You get Uzziah here. Listen, if they were to get right, and you know they're not going to, man, they can beat the entire Middle East up right now, the United Nations, and really just throw the media into a complete uproar. This little people called the Jews destroyed off. Yeah, but that's what you read in Chronicles. When you got a king that did right, God blessed him with victory of war, and then they turn and say, thou shalt not kill. Well, what do you get in verse 6 and verse 7? Philistines, Arabians, and Midianites had to die. Man has to die for his sin, for the Bible says the wages of sin is death. Now there is no king in Israel today. And there will not be a king in Israel until the Lord Jesus Christ sits on David's throne. All because they crucified their Messiah. And at Paul's preaching, rejected what Paul had to say. In 70 AD, they were destroyed by the nation that they said, here, kill our Messiah. And the Amorites, or Ammonites, those are the children of Lot, gave gifts unto Uzziah, and his name spread abroad even to the entering in of Egypt. For he strengthened himself exceedingly. So Uzziah had a name. This guy you don't mess with. He has that God. And especially in Egypt. Well, wait a minute. We don't want to deal with that Israel God because we remember what our fathers told, how that God kicked our butt down here. I mean, we had fish die, the water turned to blood, every firstborn died, we had lice, we had plagues, we had everything. We don't want to mess with Uzziah, and we sure don't want to mess with that God again. You just keep those Jews, and you keep that God out of Egypt. Thank you very much. That's the name. You know what? I bet you if you were to send people down in Egypt and explain to them the God, I bet you people would have got saved in the Old Testament sense. How can people get saved today by the New Testament, by the church age, when there is no fear of God? God won't put you in hell. No. He's a loving God. When we all get to the great white throne judgment, we're all going to get slapped on the wrist and slapped on the back, and we're all going to go to heaven. Well, what do you need to fear God for that? God helped him against the Philistines, against the Arabians that dwelt in Gerbaal and the Mahanims. And the Ammonites gave gifts unto Uzziah, and his name spread abroad even to the entering of Egypt, for he strengthened himself exceedingly. Moreover, Uzziah built towers in Jerusalem. Man, he's fortified, he's strengthened. There's no war. What do you do when there's no war? You build up to prepare for war. Listen, as long as man is on this planet, you've got to realize there's going to be a conflict somewhere. You're going to fight. Somebody on the street is always bigger and better than the other person. We're not in peace yet, but the Bible says in Isaiah, there is no peace, saith the Lord, to the wicked. And we're all under sin, and those who are not washed under the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, who have not trusted the God of the Bible, they're definitely going to duke it out because they're under Satan. And you don't believe they're under Satan? Listen, one of the things that Satan told Jesus, I'll give you all the world. It's mine. And Jesus did not rebuke him. He said, should a Christian be in the White House? No. Government authority is under the control of Satan. Luke chapter 4 and Mark chapter 4, I believe it is. Or Matthew 4. I know it's definitely Luke 4. At the corner gate. So that's a great place to build a tower at the corner. And at the valley gate. Well, that's down a valley, and you know when trouble's going to come, you better look out and see it. And it's always good when you're in a valley to look forward and see something sticking up. Anything looks good in a valley, something, you know, you can look your eyes upon and say, hey, I can get up. And to turn the wall and fortify them. He also built towers in the desert and digged many wells. Well, you need wells for people. You need wells for animals. Water is that substance of life. You can't build a city. You can't build a civilization where there's no water. It has to be brought in. And you take a godforsaken place like Las Vegas. They got to pump all that water in to keep that city. If they were to turn off that water, that city would be a ghost town. Amen. Glory to God. Pray for Brother Bear and their people. That's a God-forsaken place, and all you have to do is turn off the water. He had much cattle. That's why he needed the water wells, both in the low country and in the plains, husbandmen also, and vine dressers in the mountains and in Carmel, for he loved husbandry. So he was a guy that got out there. He got involved with animals. He got involved in plants. He was active. He just didn't sit on the front. He did something. Moreover, Uzziah had a host of fighting men, army, that went out to war by bands, according to the number of their account, by the hand of Jehiel, the scribe, and Manasseh, the ruler, under the hand of Hananiah, one of the king's captains. So he had an army that was in bands. That means they were orderly. They knew what to do. They knew how to do it. And they had people put in charge over there. The whole number of the chief of the followers and the mighty men of valor were 2,600. And under their hand was an army, 300,000 and 7,500, that made war with mighty power to help the king against his enemies. So verse 11, you had the elite men. Today you would call them the Navy SEALs, the airborne, and in verse number 13 was just the regular army. So he didn't just have an army, he had men that really could fight. He didn't call women into service. He didn't call wimps into service to play electric guitars and piccolos and all the junk that the army says is a career. And it's amazing if you read an army brochure on what you can go in an army and have a career with. And Uzziah prepared for them throughout all the host shields, protection, and spears of weapons and helmets, protection, habergeons, protection, and bows, that's weaponry, and slings, weaponry, to cast stones. Man, he had offensive and he had defensive items for these men. He made sure they were well equipped. He made in Jerusalem engines invented by cunning men to be on the towers, upon the bulwarks, to shoot arrows and great stones with up. So not only did he use his men for artillery, he had these catapults, he had all these kinds of things built. Listen, the people, this is your first missiles. And then it'd be like the army be voting, they'll start firing these things even before they get to the city. He had an advantage. He had God. What a defense that if you can protect your city long before they even got to the city. Listen, when they had battles against the city, those people were right there up against the wall trying to burn your wooden doors down. If you can defeat them before they even come within the radius of your city, you got it. And that's exactly what he's done. And his name spread far aboard. I bet you it did. Watch out for that Uzziah. You don't want to mess with that king in that city. You're going to see a thing when we went through Ezra and Nehemiah. They go back to the king and say, this city was rebellious. This city did this. This city wouldn't pay. This is one of the things. This city was protected by God. I mean, the Philistines got their butt kicked. The Arabians got their butt kicked. Egypt was destroyed before them. Jericho, the wall fell down just because they shouted. All under the power of God. Now, without the power of God, they were destroyed. They were put to tribute. His name spread far abroad, and he was marvelously helped. Now, that comma there was only a period. Everything would be hunky-dory. That comma in 2 Chronicles 26:15 might have put Uzziah in hell. that comma, united we stand, American pride, Boston proud, proud to be American, blah, 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 blah. I love thy rocks, I love thy rills. God was proud when Jesus went to the cross. You don't find anywhere in the Bible pride, proud, associated with God, and you don't ever find it associated with good or righteousness. Because it says, till he was strong. Look at what I can do. Look at all these towers I built. Look at the walls. Look at these engines I made. Look at all the wells. Look at what I did. I did it. We made it in Jerusalem. Yay! Satan walks up to God and says, hey, God, how about Uzziah? Yeah, what about Uzziah? Just like Job. Job was self-righteous. You know, we kept on talking about every time there's a victory, the devil shows up. Every time there's pride, the devil's already been there. We saw the victory, didn't we? He's building all these machinery. He's building all these places. He's got the victory in fighting wars. He's conquering the enemies of God. He's got a name. And Satan comes in. What tool does he use? He uses pride. Did you see that? Did you see Satan working behind where he's getting, look what I can do. Satan's like, yes, I got you. I've got you. You keep on doing what you're doing. You get the church of the thousand. You save 500 people in your village. You got 300 baptized and all that. Probably re-baptism. Who knows? You got glory in numbers. You got glory in victory. You're doing so great. Yay, pat myself on the back, and Satan's in charge. It has nothing to do with God. We can't stop the story there. I wish we could. You want a revival in America? You got to get rid of the pride. You want a revival in the church? You got to get rid of the pride. Oh, we had 500 in Sunday school. Whoa. We had 700 in the school. And we had, well, we had everybody that give $5,000 to this thing. And then we have 300 missionaries that we support. Much of them don't do nothing for the Lord, but we do support them. We have this, and, you know, we can swallow more goldfish in the church down the street, and we had, you know, all this kind of stuff in our church last week, and we got all these kind of things, but we don't count how many children are not really saved, how many people are not doing for anything for the Lord, how many families are messed up, how many people really, truly got saved last year. We don't look at those numbers. We don't look at, the Bible says that the church says, I'm rich, I'm increased of goods, I have no need of nothing. And God says, you're wicked, you're miserable, you're naked, and you need eye medicine because you can't even look at yourself. So what God calls this church age is, you are a liar. Liar, liar. Your works will be on fire if you had any. Wood, hay, or stubble. We can't finish here. But, that's a bad but. 2 Chronicles 26:16, that's a bad but. But when he was strong, his heart was lifted up to his destruction. Do you see Satan? Tell me where you see God in that. Tell me where God has pride. I'll see God smack you right in the face in the judgment seat of Christ if that's where you're going. When he was strong, his heart lifted up, destruction. That don't sound like God to me. For he transgressed, that sounds like another good word, against the Lord his God. Pride will cause you to transgress against God. And went into the temple of the Lord. That sounds good. Nothing wrong with going to the temple of the Lord to burn incense upon the altar of incense. Well, look at the intentions first. He maybe wanted, offer something to the Lord. That's not bad. But he's not a priest. He's in the holy place. He's in the same place that John the Baptist's father is, where Gabriel shows up. How do you know that John the Baptist knew that wasn't no ordinary guy who did not have wings? Because of Uzziah. John the Baptist's father knew in the back of his head, listen, nobody who does not belong here needs to be here and has the authority to be here. God would do something like Uzziah. And no, Gabriel did not have wings. He's an ordinary man. He reads the scriptures. So he's burning incense. And Azariah the priest went in after him, and with him 80 priests of the Lord that were valiant men. How strong was Uzziah? He had to call 80 valiant priests with him. That's how strong Uzziah was. Now, I got to ask you something. What kind of strength? Muscles or spiritual, now that he has the devil on his side? Think about that one. He's already under Satan with pride, his heart. This guy has to call 81 priests, counting himself, of valiant men. 81 men versus one. The Bible, the law, and this is a priest, he knows the law, states, at the mouth of 2 or 3 witnesses shall be established, he should have called 3 other priests then, would have been 4. And say, hey, here's the law, you don't belong here. Alright, it would have been established, but they got to call 81 men into this guy. And they withstood Uzziah the king, and said unto him, it appertaineth not unto thee, Uzziah, to burn incense unto the Lord, but to the priests, the sons of Aaron. Remember, priests are Levites, but all Levites are not priests. Only Aaron's sons. Well, what's that tell you about John the Baptist's father? He was a son of Aaron. This is what Uzziah is telling you. This is preparing you for John the Baptist's father when he goes into the burn incense. You just read it. Can only, that's the sons of Aaron, could be there to burn incense. If John the Baptist's father, I can never remember his name, that's why I'm saying John the Baptist's father. If he was not a son of Aaron, according to Uzziah, he would have had leprosy too, or would have died there. And that explains to you why Gabriel smote John the Baptist's father with unable to speak, because there should have been no other man in there unless it was sent from heaven. In other words, John the Baptist's father should have knew that was an angel sent by God, because he was not of Aaron's. That's why the angel smote him. And Gabriel told him, said, I'm sent of God. Alright, got that? Scripture with scripture. That are consecrated to burn incense. Go out of the sanctuary, for thou hast trespassed, neither shall it be for thine honor from the Lord God. So John the Baptist's father was a son of Aaron, and he was consecrated. He was set apart, and it says in the book of Luke, chapter 1, that him and his wife Elizabeth did good. I forget how exactly it said, but they lived perfectly. He was a consecrated man of Aaron to do right. according to a little book called, chapter called 2 Chronicles chapter 26, which nobody reads because it's boring, but it tells you about John the Baptist's father. Did you know about that? Because where he was offering prayer, he was offering incense. And here we are at the incense altar. We are standing at the veil. Poke your head through the veil and there's the Holy of Holies. He's where the candlestick is, where Samuel was. And it went out. Then Uzziah was wroth and had a censer in his hand to burn incense. While he was wroth, the priest, the leprosy even rose in his forehead, the same spot where Goliath was put to sleep. The same place where 666 goes. I believe Elimelech was killed in the forehead by a piece of millstone. Caesarea, he got it in the temples. That's close enough. Mind the foreheads in the Bible. There's a forehead in the tribulation is where 666 goes. That's where they're supposed to say the third eye is. Before the priest of the house of the Lord, from beside the incense altar. And Azariah, the chief priest, and all the priests looked upon him, and behold, he was leprous in his forehead. And they thrust him out from thence. Yea, himself hastened also to go out, because the Lord has smitten him. Now, does that sound like pride is great? He's smitten with leprosy for the rest of his life. He's an outcast. We're going to see in a minute. I'm going to read you something. He's no longer king, really, but he's king, but he's no longer king. And it says in Revelation, those that get the mark will be smitten. And Uzziah the king was a leper unto the day of his death, and dwelt in a several, that means a different, and not out of the ordinary, an unusual house, being a leper, for he was cut off from the house of the Lord. Means he couldn't go to the temple anymore. How could he give his sacrifice? He couldn't. And Jotham, his son, was over the king's house, judging the people of the land. Now, Jotham, here's an over-reign. His father is still king, but he can't reign because he's got leprosy, so Jotham, his son, takes over. Now, there's a note here I got about Uzziah. The burying place found by archaeology. And they found this inscription. And this is funny. Well, not funny. Aha. To this place where the bones of Uzziah, king of Judah, do not open. That's all it says. Now, if you didn't know scripture, you didn't know your Bible, hey, I open it and be a little curious, and guess what? According to the priest, the law, Numbers 13 or 14, or Deuteronomy 13 and 14, one of the chapters, talks about leprosy. They're warning you that you can get leprosy even from a dead man's body, his bones. Archaeologists found this inscription, which backs up 2 Chronicles 26. This king had a disease where you don't open his bone. So it says, now the rest of the acts of Uzziah, first and last, did Isaiah the prophet.
Oh.
We're in Isaiah's time now. Isaiah is walking about preaching and teaching. The son of Amos wrote. So Uzziah slept with his fathers, and they buried him with his fathers in the field of the burial which belonged to the kings, where they said, he's a leper. And Jotham, his son, reigned in his stead. Well, with archaeology, we read that they buried this guy. They sealed him up with a message. Do not open. Now, let me ask you a question. How did they bury Lazarus? Well, they wrapped him up and put him in a tomb, right? How did they bury Jesus? They wrapped him up and put him in a tomb, right? Uzziah, they put him in some kind of, can I say, canister. And sealed it with that note, do not open. So they buried him with the, it says they buried him with the fathers, but they buried him in a box. And Jews didn't do that. Jews did it in bomb. Wouldn't it have been funny if they had bombed Lazarus and Jesus called him out of the grave 4 days later without a stomach, heart, brain? Isn't it great that the Jews don't embalm? You know, when the woman's coming down the street with her son who's died, Jesus touches the beard and the sun rises. When Elijah raises the young man from his mother that died. You read all those things. They didn't bomb, they didn't put him in. But Uzziah, we learned by archaeologists, those priests saw it as such a thing, and the law prescribed with leprosy that they sealed him in something and put a warning. And why did all that happen? Back in 26 verse 15, that marvelously held that comma. Till he was strong, but when he was strong, his heart was lifted up, pride. America's being destroyed because of pride. The black people are being destroyed because their pride of race. Christians and their pride of numbers, their pride of look at us, is being destroyed or destroying them. Pride kills. That's plain and simple. That's a Bible fact, and you can't say otherwise. We'll close there.